Okay, we are ready. Let's begin. So today we have defense of course works on our third year and fifth year students from Moscow State. So we have how many?
Four.
Four students, and each student will be given 10 minutes to briefly introduce their research, the results, and then about 5 minutes for the questions and discussion. Among other skills, we'll test your ability to introduce problem formulation and results during a predefined amount of time. So this time it's 10 minutes. So Michael, please be our commentator. Okay?
Okay, my name is Alek, and the topic of my research is missing features imitation using conditional variation after encoder. My talk will be organized as follows. Firstly, I will tell about variation after encoders, then about the extension conditional variation after encoders, and then about the further extension conditional variation after encoders for missing features imputation, which is actually the topic of my coursework. So variation after encoder is the following graphical model. It assumes following generative process. First with a simple latent vector Z from standard normal distribution, and then we sample X conditioned on given for each object vector Z, and sample parameters theta. The distribution over X given Z and theta is modeled by neural network. This network calls generative network, and its parameters are theta. To learn our generative model, we maximize its log likelihood with respect to theta. To perform this optimization, we introduce proposal distribution Q of the Z given X. It is also modeled by a neural network with parameters phi, and using this proposal distribution, we can derive the so-called variation lower bound for our log likelihood and maximize it with respect to phi and theta. Okay, on this slide we can see the scheme of variation after encoder, and here is the latent space representations for variation after encoder trained on MNIST dataset. Conditional variation after encoders solve the problem of estimation of the distribution on Y given X. Conditional variation after encoder is also generative model, and it is efficient when the space of Y is complex, and our goal is to obtain the distribution over Y given X, but not the most probable Y or the average Y. The variational lower bound for this model is very similar to variational lower bound for variational after encoder. The only difference is that all distributions now are conditioned on X. This results in in your non-trivial distribution over Z conditioned on X, it is also modeled by neural network. It's called prior network. It is necessary because on the test stage where we have to predict Y's, we cannot use a proposal network because it needs Y and we don't have Y. So the only way to sample Z's efficiently is to use a prior network. So here is an example of using conditional relation of encoders. The problem setting is prediction of the lower part of the image given the upper part of the image. We can see the samples from conditional variation of the encoder obtained by sampling first Z from prior network and then Y from generative network. You can see that the samples are sharp and diverge. The majority of them is more or less natural. If we are trying to reduce number of networks and put the prior network equal to the proposal network, we obtain a simple feed-forward stochastic neural network, its results are worth the negative log likelihood is much more, the generated samples are not sharp, they are similar to average lower part of the image, because we have no information in generative network what exactly lower part we want to reconstruct. Okay, that was about why we need all three of these networks. My problem is missing feature imputation using variational of the encoders. We can state missing feature imputation problem as follows. We have some random vector X, we can observe some of its components. We call them observed components. Other components are missing components. We want to get the distribution of missing components with given values of observed components. Also, we have some distribution of our set of missing components, so to learn a model for solve the problem, we have to solve the following optimization problem. The main difference between conditional variation of the encoder and our model is that in conditional variation of the encoder, missing components are fixed, while in our models we have a distribution over them. To solve the problem, we introduce missing features mask, which is a binary d-dimension vector. What we observe is vector b and x dot 1 minus b. And what we want to estimate is distribution over x, x dot b. Dot here means element-wise multiplication. So we also obtained variational lower bound for this problem formulation. To solve it, we also use three neural networks, proposal, generative, and prior. What about experimental evaluation of for this model. First experimental setup is on synthetic data. We use six-dimensional vector x. Its distribution is a mixture of four Dirichlet distributions with random parameters. Z parameters are uniform variables from 0 to 10. Uniform random variables. And we assume the distribution of masks is also uniform. So we can obtain the analytical density function. We fix the value of the fifth and the sixth component, and we can obtain the analytical density function for other components. And we can obtain density function with the use of our model on these components. We can sample from these distributions, and we can obtain histograms for the marginal density of the third component with conditioned on fifth and sixth component. On the left, we can see analytical density function, and on the right, we can see the density function restored with our model. We can see that they differ, but they have the similar shape, and we can see that our model doesn't fall into model of distribution or into averaging of distribution. So the shape stays. The shape stays. The second experimental setup is prediction the digit with only one line of it given.
We're out of time. 30 seconds.
So please be brief.
Okay, we can see that model also works in this setting. The digits are sharp and different, and the majority of them looks also natural. So we can conclude that our model can solve the problem of missing features imputation. That's all.
The last slide reminds me the results of paleontologists are able to restore the whole skeleton of a dinosaur by using just single bone. So they take single bone and they restore the remaining part. So we are doing something like this, but on mnist, not with dinosaurs, but with digits.
Are they also able to restore multiple dinosaurs out of single bone?
The distribution over the space of dinosaurs.
Sorry, are there any baselines here? Did you compare your model with some other models to restore missing features, or you just give results from your model and what? Where is comparison with some baselines?
Here is not a comparison with baselines. It can be performed in image embedding problem,
but it looks like that we need to compare.
Yeah, I guess it's also a question of related work. Do you have any review of related work for the problem you are solving? For the feature imputation.
As far as I know, there are no baselines with an arbitrary mask distribution. Mm-hmm. So image embedding is the case when we have one rectangle as a mask. We don't compare with it because we had not enough time.
But you're going to.
Yeah.
Anyway, are there any other practical settings where this missing feature imputation problem is actually arises? Because now it seems like absolutely synthetic setting. You imagine that, okay, let's have a situation that we don't see some set of features. But are there any practical settings where we actually have this situation?
Okay, there are several practical settings. First is when we actually have some missed features. It is quite a common case.
No, common case when we do not have some features because we even can't measure them. But you here consider a situation that they actually can be measured, but we don't do this. It's a bit different thing.
No, there are different situations, but it is also quite a common situation. When you can measure features, but...
It's too expensive, probably, or...
Well, you're too expensive, or you're too lazy, or you have just lost some features. For example, in medicine, this is quite a typical situation. I mean, you have some missing data. Because some patients were not taken some analysis.
Well, this sort of the problem was, again, the BMS problem when we have a query on the table and we want to estimate some statistics over some columns with equal clauses on another columns. And using this technique, we can sample fast a lot of data and estimate these statistics.
So it would be better to include this thing into the work.
Well, probably it's
somehow.
It's so under
this motivation. Yep.
Another question: there are other data sets used except for these.
No, as far as I remember, only synthetic enemies now.
Synthetic, you mean random generators?
Yes, the case when we can compute the true distribution analytically.
I have a slight suggestion. When you introduce conditional validation of affine colors, probably you should try to keep the notation the same as in case of regular variation of after encoders, because right now you switch variables, you condition on X, which was previously the target variable you were modeling, and that might be a little bit confusing to those who are not familiar with these models. So try to make notation consistent across these models.
Okay.
Can you go back to the GIF?
Was
it a GIF?
It's a GIF. Or static image?
Well, no, there
was
no GIF.
Really?
Yeah.
No, not this one.
What have you drunk?
This was static image.
What have you eaten?
It's not static.
Really?
Yes.
Probably this is some kind of an optical illusion that only happens when you sit right in front of.
I'm trying to look only at one number.
Okay,
just
concentrate for the discussion as well.
Oh my god.
Okay, let us invite the next speaker. Надежда.
I didn't prepare it as a defense. I thought it is like I was preparing to explain what I do, so probably I will not be on time, but I hope I will. Is there a specific switch or no?
You need a clicker?
Yeah.
If you can set it up quickly, here you go.
In my 10 minutes?
Yes.
Misha, please stop.
So please hurry up.
Where you switch tone?
Yeah, don't forget to switch
okay.
it up.
Several weeks ago...
Switch it on.
There is a switcher on the side.
On each side.
Where?
Artem. Thank you, Artem. Okay. Several weeks ago, Arsenio Ashuha told us about relational dropout for fully connected and convolutional networks. And I will tell you about our research we with Katya Lobachova were working on for the last 3 months. And it is about applying of this variational dropout to the recurrent neural networks. First, I will briefly describe the model proposed on MIPS 2016, where there was the first successful attempt of applying usual binary dropout to RNNs. Then I will tell about the problems of this approach and how can we solve it using variational dropout, and also give some results of experiments. So we will talk about the problem of predicting some scalar value given some sequence of inputs, and we will work with recurrent neural networks that map this sequence of inputs into a sequence of states, and the last state is used to predict our target variable. We will denote recurrent layer weights by this way, and also we assume that we have some training set of such sequences and targets. As I told, in this work, the first successful attempt of applying binary dropout to RNNs was supposed. What did they do? They proposed a theoretical explanation based on Bayesian framework why their model works. So they assume that RNN is a Bayesian network, so weights are random variables on which you put prior. The prior is fully factorized and it is standard normal distribution. And also they put posterior on the weights. The posterior is factorized over weight rows. So for each row in a matrix of input to hidden and hidden to hidden, we have a separate posterior. And this posterior is a mixture of two normal distributions. First with zero mean, and the last with the mean we learn. And the same thing for hidden to hidden matrix. So we fix parameters px and ph, and tune just the mean values of our weights. To find this posterior, we optimize variational lower bound. Here, we must unroll this expression because our target depends on all inputs from 1 to t. So we obtain the following expression. KL divergence here can be approximated by L2 regularizer because this KL divergence is the sum of KL divergences between a mixture of normals and normal. This integral is estimated by one Monte Carlo sample. So for each separate object, we sample one weight. So how do we perform this sample? We assume that sigma is really low, so these normal distributions can be treated like delta functions. So to sample the row of the weight matrix, we flip a coin with probability p, we get zero weights, and with probability 1 minus p, get weights we learn. It is equivalent to multiplying the input of the layer to zero. And the same thing with hidden states. So sampling of our weights is equivalent to putting binary multiplicative mask on the input and hidden neurons. And because of this expression, we have to put this weight the same for all moments of the time. And this is objective we learn. We even do not need here regularization trick because parameters p are fixed. So we just we even do not perform variational inference. We just optimize our usual loss with L2 regularization. So one of the main problems of this approach is that we have to set hyperparameters dropout rates. As we remember, in variational dropout, there is a way how to tune these rates automatically. So the first problem we were solving was to automatically tune dropout parameters. Because we have Gal's model, previous model described, that really works, our key idea was to try to repeat this model, but in the formulation of our rational dropout. And this is what we do. So the prior on weights is set like in this paper. It is log uniform prior. And the posterior is set in the following way. In the original paper, for example, for fully connected neural networks, the posterior is the following. We put on each weight multiplicative normal noise. So our weights become, our posterior on weights is factorized into normal distributions. But also in this paper, they describe the model where there is one normal scalar noise on the row in the matrix of weights. And this is equivalent to putting Gaussian multiplicative noise on the input of the layer. And we repeat this in our model. So we sample one scalar noise from normal distribution for the whole matrix of weights. And we learn both mean values and dropout parameters. Ration of our bones stays the same as in Gal's model, but here our KL divergence doesn't depend on the mean parameters, means of weights. That's because of log uniform prior distribution. It depends just on the dropout parameter, and as we know from Arseny's talk, it can be closely approximated by this form, and we use it. And as in previous model, we estimate the integral by just one sample. As I told, this model is equivalent to putting not binary but Gaussian multiplicative noise on input and hidden neurons, and this noise is the same for all time moments of the time. And here our posterior we are learning and we are sampling from depends on the parameters we are learning. Thus, we need a reparameterization trick when we sample. And since all our distributions are normal, the form of this reparameterization trick is usual for us. We have discussed it a lot on our seminars. Okay, we have the model that can automatically tune dropout parameters. The second step we are working on now is how to sparsify our NANDs using the rational dropout. And what we need to do this is to put individual dropout rates for each weight. Here we use the model proposed in Kinmai et al. And this paper. So we have each weight, posterior on weight is normal of this form. And it is equivalent to putting multiplicative Gaussian noise on each weight. Also in this paper, the reparameterization is proposed, this reparameterization. So this is additive noise on weight. In this case, the posterior of the weight stays the same. We just change the parameterization, so we don't change the model. In this case, we will sample Gaussian additive noise on weights, not multiplicative as in previous one. And there is one problem that the local reparameterization trick that worked well, for example, in this paper, doesn't work for RNNs. So we have to sample noise directly on weights, not on the preactivation, as here. That's why we sample weight not for every object in batch, but the same weights for the batch. And it increases the variance of gradients, but it works somehow. And the mask is the same for all moments of time as previous. It is our objective. It changes just that the changes that we put here individual KL divergence. Now some words about experiments. Here is experiments with the Gal's dropout. This is the first model I described with posterior in the form of a mixture of Gaussians. In the paper, the original paper, they showed blue line, and this line shows on the x-axis is epoch, and on the y-axis is strain and test error. And the blue line shows that the model doesn't overfit even with large number of people. But in the paper they wrote that they fine-tuned dropout rate on cross-validation. And if we try another dropout rate, we see that with small dropout rates the model overfits because we have low MSE on the train and high on test. Okay. And with a large it overfits, it underfits. This is our experiment. Here blue line is again Gauss dropout, green is ours, and we can see that we tune dropout rate automatically and have pretty the same behavior of the curve as in Gauss dropout. And this is result for variation dropout with individual rates. Here we pre-train model with no regularization for 500 of epochs and see that here model somehow overfits. And then we become to sparsify, began sparsifying of it. At the end we get worse quality but 93% of sparsity. And now we are working on improving these results. That's all.
Okay, any questions?
Yeah. A question on sampling. As I understand, you use the trained weight for the RNN, or you use the random weight with mean zero. And the question is, how often do you sample, like for each sample, for each training sample, or for mini batch, or like for the whole
With the second model with just two dropout rates, we sample for each object because we put noise on input. It is not expensive. And when we try to sparsify RNN, we have to put noise not on inputs but on weights, and it is expensive. So we put it on the batch, not on.
Well, are there any practical purpose to sparsify RNN?
To compress it, to use, for example, on mobile phones.
Yes, but it seems that usually RNN, they are not big.
Okay, there is a problem that the largest part of the RNN is embedded layer. And we plan to conduct experiments where we use variational dropout for this layer too. And this will have really practical use.
Mm-hmm. Actually, the most important in RNN is not compression, but acceleration. And acceleration can be achieved if we reduce the number of recurrent neurons. And to reduce it, we need sparsity. If we are able to sparsify some neurons, we'll be able to accelerate.
But if we sparsify in arbitrary way, just some weights, that's not lead to acceleration.
Well, sometimes it can.
Acceleration if we sparsify with respect to time. For instance,
with respect to what?
To time. We do not need to propagate gradients to the big horizons.
That this means sparsify neurons rather than weights.
No. Sanish wants to make a prediction earlier than we read the whole sequence.
Yeah.
But this is that's impossible.
No, it's not impossible. And we spoke about this with Misha,
today?
No, I think half a year ago.
Some adaptive computation time?
Yes.
In RNNs?
Yes.
Did you mean this?
Yes, because it seems that arbitrary weights do not actually lead to acceleration.
No.
Arbitrary weights do not.
Yes, but we want to have group sparsity, but we can't do it yet.
Okay.
You can also
and group sparsity, we'll be able to accelerate.
Without group sparsity, there is a paper by Baidu on iClear this year, which shows that you can achieve sparsity for about 25 times, so only 4% of the weights remain, and then you apply just sparse matrix multiplication, and you get speed up for about 7 times. So it's not 25 times, but 7 times is also good. But you need really, really high sparsity for that.
And how much sparsity do we have now?
93%, but with some loss of quality.
Yes. That's it, but, well, we still have time to improve our results. And at least as a proof of concept, it works, which is already surprising. So thank you, Nadia. Next is Nikita.
Accelerates training process. Okay, why training deep neural networks is so hard? There are two reasons that I suppose the most important for my report. First is internal accurate shift. It problem was introduced in paper batch normalization and refer to all the paper. Without going into details, the data then propagate from layer to layer continuously changes distribution, and optimizers reach optimal point slower. And the second problem is vanishing gradients. It is a famous problem in ML community. I don't talk about this. Okay, if we simple stack in fully convolutional neural network, we can't get higher accuracy. For example, we get six layers sigmoid activations neural network, and we see that when we add six layer, accuracy decreases to fall down. That's it, T4 10. If we plot activations after each output of layers in six layer sigmoid neural network, we see that after third layer, standard deviation of vector is close to zero. Data don't transform. How we can address it? We can use batch normalization. Batch normalization uses mini-batch statistics to standardize data after each linear transformation. Also adds gamma and beta parameters to allow identity transfer method. And batch normalization works well. We see that our networks can train, and max accuracy increases. Activations looks well too. After third layer, activations is activation standard deviation is close to one. Batch minimization has disadvantages. For example, batch minimization work purely with a small batch. Normalization propagation is another way to normalize layers. For example, we have X with expectation zero and identity covariance matrix. And for linear transformation U, we also have zero expectation, but covariance matrix changes. But if we do small correction on a linear transformation, expectation else be zero, but on diagonal of covariances we get ones. Non-diagonal elements will be that form. Maximum of such these values in the weight matrix called cogredience, and for the big enough matrix, coherence is close to zero. But non-linearity else shifts statistics and distribution, and we can introduce C1 and C2 parameters, where can be computed numerically if we know distribution of X. For real data, distribution is usually normal. And we see in graphics about normalization propagation also work well and also have a great statistics. But how we can improve these results? They can do two things. First, we know that covariance matrix is approximately identity matrix. Therefore, W matrix is approximately orthogonal. Well, if it is so important for normalization propagation, we can initialize the matrix, weight matrix, strictly to orthogonal, and we get covariance is strictly identity. Second thing is adding new parameters. We can add gamma and beta parameters like batch normalization. But we can get gamma second auxiliary role. We can make gamma correct Jacobian. Let J is Jacobian of layer of outputs from respect to input, and we can sample we can sample singular values of Jacobians. We know that value of gradient depends of product of all norms of such Jacobians, and we can get init values of gamma, what can correct Jacobian and improve backpropagate step. We see what for sigmoid and tangent situations gamma is close to 1 and gamma correction is not necessary, but for ReLU we have a firm motivation to use gamma correction. And we see that if we train a very deep fully connected neural network with 45 layers, norm probe with improvements get accuracy with get high accuracy. Moreover, norm probe with improvements can get high accuracy than batch normalization on same neural network. And it is interesting that norm probe works more faster. Batch normalization activations, neural probe activations for these layers. We see about standard deviation and mean shifts, but accuracy don't fall down. A neural probe can be used with convolution neural networks. It is. Can be used with convolution neural networks, but we cannot get advantage as a fully connected network for no problem. In conclusion, I want to say that normalization propagation is just another layer normalization way, and norm probe is the best thing for fully connected neural networks because it works faster and can get high accuracy for deep networks than batch normalization. But with convolution neural networks with ReLU activations, we hope get more impressive result in future. That's all.
Okay, thank you. So any questions?
Can you use normalization propagation in the
practical networks? Можно было бы очень сложно, правда.
Можно.
Normalization propagation можно в recurrent
experiments? Насколько я понимаю, вот здесь так не получится сделать.
Почему?
Ну, на самом деле, у меня хороший. У нас вообще вопрос сейчас, как это использовать для сверток, если дело то пошло, потому что со свертком есть там большое количество проблем, связанных там, с недостатком статистик. И
Извини, со свертками это рекуррентных никаких сверток нет.
Ну, согласен, да. Но что-то возможно. Просто мое внутреннее убеждение говорит, что вряд ли.
А вообще используют, по-моему,
вообще нет, насколько я знаю, там это не используется.
Вообще, много статей ты видел, в которых новый преп используется?
Нет, у меня просто во всех статьях про рекуррентов, когда говорят, что давайте сделаем, типа, избавимся от vanishing gradients, они никогда не думают о том, что ReLU, вообще говоря, vanishing gradients тоже по норме уменьшает.
Mm-hmm.
То есть они выбирают тревогу как наименее уменьшающую, и все.
Ну, вот тут я не успел вставить.
Я понимаю, просто пытайтесь это править.
Я не услышал просто, на самом деле. Вообще, не ставил один слайд, который мне сказали, что вообще по-хорошему надо было ставить. Это где для 45 слоев мы использовали разные функции активации. И на удивление получалось, что там сигмоид работал лучше всех. Потому что сеть очень глубокая, и там вот этот вот параметр гамма, который отвечает за коррекцию якобиан, он больше влияние, он более важен, в общем, чем даже нормировки оказывался. И поэтому сигмоидные сети даже лучше оказывались.
Забавно.
Да.
Можете один из первых графиков показать? Я не очень понял, почему у вас там по слоям точность падает? Чем больше слоев?
Не-не-не, это не слоев. Это нейронная сеть с одним слоем скрытым, с двумя, с тремя, с четырьмя, с пяти.
Ну, нет, я правильно так и понял. Почему чем больше слоев, тем ниже точность?
Ну это сигмоидная функция
активации.
Ну не настолько же.
Нет, почему? Сигмоидная функция активации с шестью слоями. Почему?
Не работает.
Уже не работает, да.
Значит, это сигмоидная функция.
Да, это сигмоидная.
Для какой задачи?
Это цифар набор данных.
На полносвязанной сети.
Да, 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 полносвязанная сеть.
Ну тогда звучит более-менее разумно.
Ну да. А если бы РИУ использовали?
РИУ был бы, наверное, лучше, но релу мы уже 45 брали, потому что и так понятно, что с релу будет более-менее нормально.
Угу.
В принципе, релу вообще без нормировок, у меня максимально получалось 35 слоев.
А как ты...
Она еще что-то там могла 35 слоев сделать.
Как ты веса инициализировал? Может быть, если бы инициализировать веса иначе, как-то там заточено под сигмоидов, может быть, тогда бы сигмоиды работали лучше?
Просто с бач-нором, с нором
пропом. Ну вот, допустим, даже просто.
Ну просто обычно либо word normal, либо he normal брали, смотрели.
Окей.
Ну там вроде есть 5 константы, которые как раз для сигмоида, для RU разные. И...
Коды никак не нормировались.
Ну в смысле, минус средний делить на стандартное отклонение.
Ну то есть нормировали стандартным образом.
Ну да.
У меня замечание к презентации, такие результаты лучше показывать таблицами, где мы, там, допустим, пробуем включать-выключать какие-то вещи, или, там, например, применяем, допустим, нормализуешь пропагейшн или бач-норм, просто так только немножко трудно воспринимать, когда много графиков показывают, по сути, близкие эксперименты, собрать это в одну картинку.
Окей. Okay, спасибо. Next is Victor.
When we apply deep learning to the data, we automatically extract features that are task-specific. And we hope that if we apply deep learning to the optimization problems, we would get automatic optimizers that are also task-specific instead of handcrafted optimizers. And you don't need to tune them. You only need to tune the architecture of optimizer. Yes. What are the existing approaches to learnable optimization? There are mainly two approaches. One is based on reinforcement learning, and the second one is based on recurrent networks. There are a couple of papers on both of the approaches. My work is based on learning to learn by gradient descent by gradient descent. It's a paper from DeepMind. Why don't I use reinforcement learning? Because it is typically used in two situations. One is when rewards are sparse or delayed, and this is not true here because we have loss at any moment, and rewards are not delayed because we do step of optimization and we immediately get our reward. And the second situation is when we can't build end-to-end differentiable model, but we can with recurrent networks. And reinforcement learning models are known to be quite hard to train. Okay. Now I will tell you about DeepMind's model and then about my improvements on it. What's the motivation? We know that gradient descent makes update of this form, like new theta is old theta minus gradient. But instead we can consider outputting step by a recurrent network, which receives gradients as input, and it has some memory, which is shown by hidden state. So the gradient RNN receives only gradients. How to train this model? We can consider this loss function. It's the weighted sum of values of the function. And we minimize it by phi, which is the parameters of optimizer. Choice of this loss function seems reasonable, because if we set all the weights to zero except the last one, we would get expected value at the last point, and that's kind of what we want to optimize. But this loss, but if we do so, that it would make backpropagation for time inefficient, because gradient would be propagated only from the last iteration. And so we, for simplicity, we set all the weights equal, and equal to 1 over t, where t is number of steps. Okay, how to compute gradient of this loss function? We just sample some function f, then we do forward computation on this computational graph, and then apply backpropagation. There is one minor detail. We don't want to compute second derivatives because it can be hard, for example, for neural networks. And so we set derivative of gradient number t with respect to phi to zero. Okay. Current model has one very important problem. Number of parameters of RNN depends on dimensionality of problem, and that's bad because first number of these parameters can be very big, like in deep neural networks, billions of parameters, and optimizer would have even more parameters. And the second point is that we want to change dimensionality of problem because like we would train on small problems, and then we'll use our optimizer for neural networks.
Is it still
DeepMind? Yes, it's still DeepMind. Mm-hmm. Thus, we employ some parameter sharing, and we want to cancel dependence on number of on dimension, so we share parameters between coordinates. Effectively, that's the same as we have an OSTM for each coordinate. It receives one coordinate of gradient and outputs one coordinate of step. And we add this step to phi, to theta, and so on. That's one iteration. In fact, that's the same as we had one OSTM, and it would receive gradient coordinates independently. Okay, let's discuss this model. First, it doesn't know that its input is gradient, and so we can input some gradient-like things, like some values which computes Adam, for example. Second point is that it is shown in some papers and in my experiments that this model overfits on some parameters, like, for example, number of iterations. And we can sample different number of iterations, And so probably optimizer wouldn't refit. I'll show you in a couple of slides. And the third problem is that it cannot achieve high accuracy even for non-stochastic settings. So we can use an ensemble of optimizers, for example. In this work, I built a chain of optimizers. And now I will show my model. For example, this is overfitting on number of iterations. This optimizer is DeepMind's model. It was trained on one epoch. And for about 88 epochs, it performs well, but then it diverges.
Is it a blue line, OSTM?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. You should label axis.
Yeah.
Yes, I'm sorry, I didn't. And another example, the right plot is from original paper. They have, OSTM is better than other optimizers, but they all have low accuracy. And the left plot is, left plot shows independence of final loss from the dimension of quadratic function. And that's because we sampled this dimension. Okay. Now I will tell you about chain of optimizers. Now we consider non-stochastic settings. Okay. Let's assume we have n optimizers. Each of them are pre-trained on different phases of optimization, and phase is set of points with function value between A and B. Okay, and we want to do this update. What does it mean? We just run all optimizers from current point and choose the best point according to the function value. There are a couple of things to know, that K is number of steps is hyperparameter. Optimizer should be trained to optimize for this number of steps, and that cost of iteration scales linearly with number of optimizers. How to train this chain? We define phases, and for each phase we train on an optimizer on problems from these phases. And how to sample from these phases. We just sample a number of problems, run an LBFJS. We get some trajectories, and then we can partition these trajectories based on function value. Then we would get points in each phase, and we just train optimizers on these functions running from these points. These are the results on Rosenberg function, blue is chain. We perform better than SGD and momentum, but we cannot come close to LBFJS. These are the results on full batch logistic regression. I think you don't see, but this line is LSTM chain, and we perform almost like LBFJS. Yes, good. What are the pros and cons of chain? It achieves high accuracy, it can be fine-tuned, and actually we can add optimizers which wasn't trained somehow. For example, we could use 5 LSTMs and SGD in chain. But there are drawbacks. We need to define what is phases. We have longer iteration, and this cost of this iteration is linear with number of iterations. And the main problem is that it's not obvious how to use this model in stochastic settings.
Victor, you're running out of time.
Okay. In stochastic version, I used as LSTM inputs Adam outputs. I didn't use chain, and now we sample random sequences of batches. Here is the results in stochastic logistic regression. Blue is the LSTM. It doesn't diverge, and it performs a bit better than other optimizers, except SAG. Results are on neural networks aren't there because it takes too long to train this optimizer on even smallest neural networks, but 1 or 2 days in least on two-layer perceptron with Tesla K80. therefore, we should train on some smaller problems, but with diverse landscapes, and then generalize to neural networks. That's what I'll do in future work. And the main idea is that we should introduce some architecture that is specific to task of optimization, of learning optimization. Yes, probably that's all. And thank you for your attention.
Okay, thanks. Any questions?
How do you define phases in practice?
In practice, I choose some number of small problems. I know what are the typical values for the I know where the typical hard phase of the optimization begins. So I choose this choose how to partition my values so that I will train a number of optimizers and receive pretty fine accuracy.
Is it log scale or they are distributed to almost uniformly?
Log scale.
Log scale.
Mm-hmm. Did you try, instead of training separate optimizers for different stages, can you instead just train one optimizer which can which outputs several possible steps, and then you just choose the optimal?
Yes, I thought about it, but I didn't implement it.
How did you generate problems on which you are learning?
Typically, there are some parameters which define the problem. For example, in Rosenberg function, there are two parameters, and I just sample them from some distributions.
And besides Rosenberg? Have you played with something else?
Yes, of course. There was
quadratic
functions.
Quadratic is not so interesting. There was
logistic regression.
This is unimodal function.
There was also Bill function, but I didn't include it. It's a multimodal function.
Mm-hmm.
And it also has some parameters, like actually I don't remember what they mean.
What was the dimensionality of those functions?
B was two-dimensional, Rosenberg two-dimensional, quadratic from 20-dimensional to about 100-dimensional. Logistic regression was to about several hundreds dimensional.
Have you tried to explore the landscape of the loss in modern DNNs?
No, that's...
At least coordinate-wise.
No, no.
Could you please show the last slide?
Future work?
Yes, yes. Digital specific. Construct diverse set of functions to train on.
Yes.
Probably you're not, you need not just diverse set, but you need some representative set of functions which look pretty similar to the typical landscape of DNNs.
Yes.
And in order to do this, you need to know what is the typical landscape, right?
Yes, but I think that there are not too many types of landscapes, and probably we can imagine some simple functions, yet they contain those types of landscapes.
No, I have no idea.
Okay.
Yes. I remember you mentioned quadratic functions, but they have like one global optima. But as far as I know, neural networks have multiple local minimums. So do you try some kind of functions which have multiple local?
Yes, I tried B function, and it has like it has quite made quite a lot of local optimums. But in practice, optimizer always converts to like nearest optimal. And
so not just global, but to nearest.
Yes.
Well, it's proven actually that you cannot perform global optimization in polynomial time. So. Well, it was proven in general case. Maybe if you constrain your problem space, then maybe you can. Either way, how do you choose k number of phases? By hand?
I
have a problem.
And how
yes,
many? How
it's
many
hyper-permitted.
Did you take?
From about 20 to 50.
Because if we are talking about possible application to neural networks, there was a paper recently that claimed that basically neural networks have two phases. One of them is error minimizing, and the second is so-called compression. So maybe it's enough to have just three of them, error minimizing, then some intermediate phase, and then compression, and kind. Somehow automatically detect a phase change.
That's the main problem, how to detect phase.
Well, probably you can look at how quickly the error the loss decreases, or validation error. I would expect it to decrease dramatically during the first stage, and then slowly go down, just as you typically see on an error plot,
mm-hmm.
where it rapidly goes down during first couple of iterations and then slowly decreases.
Yes, probably I should consider it in the future.
Okay, if there are no questions, let us thank all the speakers. I kindly remind them that the deadline for the coursework is 30 April 30th, and then we'll have about 10 to 11 days for course reviewing, and in a week we'll have pre-defense of our fourth year MSU students, right? Or sixth year students as well. So we have the only sixth year student, Pasha. So Pasha plus three of our bachelor students. So please be prepared. And these paper defenses will be in Russian. And the time format is the same. 10 minutes for the talk, and then 5 minutes for the discussion.